Although I'm already busting out of my dresses. It's too much brown much you and brown the suit, so that's the challenge.
Yes, you were telling me about your trip to Kamakwe.
Yes, I enjoyed it. It was definitely an adventure.
Kamakwe already?
Yes, but I enjoyed it because I think you see something different when you actually get out of the city, don't you?
Yeah.
That's the thing. In fact, His Excellency said to me that that's one of the things for him that opens his eyes when he's out and about in the countryside. Mm-hmm. So, and you see a very different reality to Cape Town, of course, don't you? So, yeah. But it was an adventure. It was an adventure.
We'll take you on our ride one day.
I hope so. That would be fantastic.
When we go and meet the kids, it would be nice for me to have that experience. Sometimes some people will come and then they'll want to come again. Sometimes they'll say, I don't know where you get the energy from. Sorry, this one, let me watch on TV. And
oh my goodness, so what can I expect when that happens? Is it an adventure?
You will enjoy it. You will enjoy it. Well, if you are a gender activist, then you definitely want to see the kids. Definitely you will enjoy it. But it's a tiring process when you have to go around this country. And today you'll meet 5,000 kids. Tomorrow you will meet 20,000. Every one of them will want to touch you. Every one of them will pull your clothes just to be close to you.
Yeah,
so then if you do that for 3-4 months, you get to a point where you feel like I'm draining.
Yes, I can imagine, because obviously everyone wants that bit of you, and you want to be as a public figure, so.
Mm-hmm. Good to see you.
Good to see you. Good to see
finally,
you.
Finally, he's just not going to be bluffing anymore.
I know. Well, I'm delighted to see you, and delighted to come to your place as well, so. And it's always interesting, just because I think we've got such a strong interest, as you said, on the activism side of the Women and Girls Agenda. It's a privilege and important to me to hear things that are going on. I know that there's been a lot of focus between women and sex on women and girls. I was watching from afar, looking at the national state of emergency on rape and some of these other difficult issues. It's been great to see.
It has been a challenge in 3 years. Very fulfilling one, because in Africa in general, not just even in Africa in general, when you talk about early marriage or rape issues, it will cost you an election.
Yes, and I'd love to hear more about that if you'd be candid.
Well, for me, His Excellency has always said, if saving one child will cost him an election, he's ready for that. At least he knows at the end of the day that he was able to save a child. So the drive on the campaign Hands Off Our Girls has gone through that, knowing full well that His Excellency is not only our He for She champion, but believe that quality starts at home. And everything that I have managed to do as a first lady is because that he had given me space and he had supported the process. And he's always our number one advisor to say, yes, this might work, this will not work. And for him, it's not a political gimmick. It's reality. For a man who was brought up by women all his life, he had women, you know, programming his life, and he's more proud of who he had become just because of those women. But at the same time, he saw the struggle those women had to go through to get him to where he is today. So those struggles are the reason why he believed that he should champion anything that had to do with women, because he knows that they struggle more, they suffer more, and he had made this his priority to see that while he's here, he can change a lot of things and give women voices and give them the space, give them the opportunity. So when he's not here, those women will also by then champion issues that involves women, and no one will be able to silence them. And the girls, which I am nurturing, giving them their opportunity to understand what their rights are. Touching a girl here in Africa is a normal thing.
So here.
You know, you could touch a girl's breast or touch their bone and think, well, it's fun. And that's not funny.
No, it's unacceptable.
Yes.
It takes different everywhere takes their own journey to recognize that.
Yeah. So we are on our own journey now. Mm-hmm. The Hands of Our Girls has been a platform where these girls are beginning to understand their body and are beginning to have their own voices. And they can now say, no, I'm not having this. Mm-hmm. And they're beginning to understand what is right and what is wrong. And they celebrate the campaign now, and they have actually taken over the campaign. They are calling themselves Fatima's Children, so which means you can't touch us. And so it means that it has resonated in every mm-hmm. household, and it does not have any political monotone in it. The kids we talk to, we don't ask them about their political background. We don't want to know who their parents are. It's none of our business. The kids we try to fight for, we don't check on them.
Mm-hmm.
And through the process and the campaign, I realized that the things that we take for granted, one of them is sanitary pad.
Yes.
We take that for granted. You have it in your house.
Mm-hmm.
It's always there. It's not a single time when I need to have a sanitary pad and I don't have one. And my kids, they know where the pad is. So they don't even tell me. They'll just come and open the drawer and take their own and go. You know, they can help themselves in my drawer for their friends because it's available.
Mm.
But that's not the case here.
No, I was shocked to hear that.
It's not the case here.
20% it's time in school loss, I understand. Yeah, Peter.
Yes, the girl, they'll miss out 84 days mm. of the year, which is a quarter,
mm.
just because they see their menstruation. So if you see a menstruation 7 days in a month, and you don't come to school because of menstruation, so 7 days, you times that by 12,
mm.
the girl, now how do you get that thing called equality?
Yes.
They have free education. Now, the free education is for everyone, but if a child will not come to school because of sanitary pad, mm. that's supposed to be everyone's right. Some girls did not know how to use a sanitary pad before we started giving them.
I can imagine. I mean, I think this is an amazing thing to do. It's one certainly that we really share your focus on this. Yet there's no point focusing on education if girls continue to be taken out of school, either whether that's through pregnancy or through the day-to-day menstrual hygiene. We've also supported pads being given to, I think, over 300,000 girls for exactly the same reasons that you say, Your Excellency, because the other part is dignity as well, isn't it? I've heard some quite horrifying stories of girls being mocked when they have their periods at school.
Yeah, but that is one, but again, it's more about the hygiene
yes.
for them.
Yeah.
Because the kind of cloth they use when they see their menstruation, it's so sickening when you listen to these girls. That's why I said maybe you want to take a tour with me one day. And just sit and listen to them, let them tell you their story. A girl will tell you, when I see my menstruation and I don't have anything, I just rip off my notepad.
Yes, yeah.
And use it to go home.
Mm-hmm.
And when you go home, what do? I look for my mom's oldest cloth and then tear them into pieces and use them.
Mm-hmm.
And what do? Well, you wash them, but you don't want to put them outside because you don't want people to see it. So you hide them places that are very unhygienic.
Mm-hmm.
And when you come to reuse them, you don't iron it, you don't do anything, just take it and mm-hmm. reuse it again. So that has been a challenge here. And
even the urban area,
yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, free time here.
Mm-hmm.
They were shocked. When we start, so when we go to school, we don't just hand over the pads. We have to teach them how to use it. Every school we go to, we have to teach them how to use it. They've never used it before. And the feedback now we get from the schools, retainership has gone up to 95%. Girls don't miss out of school anymore. And the fear of early marriage, last year, 95% of the girls came back because when they try to force them into early marriage, the girls will say we're going to go on social media and get the first lady to know, so everybody back up. So they're beginning to use social media for the right purpose now.
Interesting, that's great.
When a child is raped and they go to the police and they don't feel like they're about to get the right justice, they go on social media.
It's interesting, isn't it, how there can be, it can be a force for good as well as a force for bad. But everything comes back to your point, I think, about education and education about the rights that you have as a young woman and a girl. And I think the more of us, particularly in positions like yours, that are helping girls understand that they can expect to have sanitary protection and look after themselves properly, that they can expect to be treated properly, and they can expect that people don't touch them in public when they don't want to, better.
And now when a friend or someone I know who owns a hotel, before, you know, there's this pride of taking young girls to these hotels over the weekend and spend the weekend there. Now they don't allow you.
Right.
If you come with a girl, they said, no, please, we don't want Fatima's trouble.
Right. Okay. No. Are you very scary? I can imagine. Yes. No one's going to disagree with you. But these are really important points, and they're norms that we've got to change.
Yes.
So I love the fact that you scare them, but with a smile.
And you know, and this guy was saying to me, said, my goodness, nobody come with kid anymore. I said,
okay.
I said, so are you happy? He said, I am so happy.
Good.
You know, because you have men who wants to champion this with you, but unfortunately they can't. So when you go at the front, they are behind you saying to you, we are with you. You need to do this because somebody needs to be at the front. And you know, and when he explained this to me, I laugh. And now I understand when they go around the beach bars, all the girls that are there will have an ID card to prove that they are above 18.
Right.
You know. So when the police come around, they say, No, we are not we are not under 18 anymore.
Right. They
you
can
know.
Prove it. They
so
can prove it.
And so it tells me that they now accept that when a girl is under 18, it is wrong. And the girls also now have acknowledged that they themselves should be the protector of their own body, and they themselves cannot endanger themselves too. So all of that is coming together. We are not there yet.
No, there's a way to go.
We're not there yet. But what we have managed to do from Freetown to any part of this country, there is not a single part of this country today that you will say hands off our girls and you don't have somebody to respond to you. There's no place in this country. And there's nowhere we haven't been yet.
Well, that's fantastic. I mean, just the fact that you've got it everywhere, because it must be a very different issues in a rural village.
Yeah.
That may come up way compared to...
Every district has their own unique story. We have, before we go there, we do our research, and then when we go there, we address their problem. And we tell them what their problem is, and they'll be shocked, like, how did they know? And we don't say it secretly. We call a huge congregational meeting where you'll have 50, 60,000 people sit, and then you tell them exactly what they're doing, and they know.
So to put it out and shine a light on it.
Yes, they know, and they'll be looking at each other like, did you tell her?
Interesting.
Yes, so.
But it needs to be made unacceptable, does it? It's big social change, which is challenging. I mean, that's why I think you're so right on the education piece, and His Excellency is very much focused, as have you, on the increase of education. So we focused on secondary education, and very much on secondary education for girls, because that is what teaches girls that they've got agency and power and their own voice.
The agencies, of course, we are not anywhere near where the UK is, because the facilities that you have, the facilities that are there, the opportunities that are there, we don't have any of that in this place. And but what this office have managed to do, we have partnership with all the agencies that are involved in, or people who said they want to fight this. We're working with Rainbow Center. They are the oldest center in this country. Since after the war, they started to protecting girls from sexual abuse. So we work with them and we compare notes. They give us our statistics that we need, because 90% of all of the victims now goes to Rainbow Center for help.
Oh, do you think?
Yes. And then lately we started going to the Aberdeen Women's Center. But the Aberdeen Women's Center deals with the more severe cases.
Yes.
Yes, so the Aberdeen Women's Center, really, their work is focused on the more like saving lives. Mm-hmm. A girl that is raped in a way where we don't even know whether that child is going to survive.
Yeah.
So they come in and help with, helping save that child. But every other rape case goes to Rainbow Center. And they sit as witness also in all court proceedings. And we work with lawyers. These are all female lawyers. They came together and they basically are providing services to rape victims and early marriage for free.
Mm-hmm.
They will represent the girls in court. And then we have the Association of Female Doctors. We have female doctors in all government hospitals today. So when a victim is brought into the hospital and the female doctor is there, they take over.
Right, so someone's got the comfort of having...
Yes, so they will be the one taking care of that person. Mm-hmm. They will be the one making sure the police, so nobody... Because sometimes before now, they will go to the hospital and they are treated, and then they hush everything. You go home, and you're still living with your perpetrator in the same community. Now, the female doctors, that's their own job, is to make sure we get justice for that girl.
Mm-hmm.
So when the child comes to the hospital, they report it. They make sure it is reported. So they will report to the family support unit at the police station. As long as it is reported to them, the police, they won't say no one can do. Because we did have that problem also. Cases go to the police station and you go to court, there will be no file.
I see, I can imagine.
Yeah.
I mean, is the prosecution rate decent?
At the moment, yes, since we had the special court.
Yeah.
Since we are the special court that sits only on rape cases.
Mm.
Yes. Most of the cases that have been to the special court, we've got a judgment on that.
Mm-hmm.
Before it wasn't like that at all, because the cases go through the main system and it stays there forever. Now the special court only sits on rape cases, so they don't deal with any other case.
No, and that's reassuring.
Mm-hmm.
And there still is so much stigma, I imagine, it's attached to a girl or a woman coming forward saying that she's experienced sexual violence or rape,
yes,
particularly if she's in a home,
yes,
with a perpetrator.
Mm-hmm.
I know one of the things that with UK Money we've been working with the Minister for Gender on is some sort of referral mechanism. So there are ways where women can be referred to support and healthcare.
What we have started doing, maybe on your way back to the resident, if you just go into the 34 Military Hospital and see what we are doing there, we're building a one-stop center. But it's the one-stop center, the type that I know how a one-stop center should be, right? A one-stop center of a European standard, where when you come into that center, everything is there. The lawyer, the doctor, the family support unit, the safe house, the hospital, everything is inside.
Interesting.
So when you come in, we will only release you if you choose to go or if we have to relocate you. So there is a safe home, but we changed the name from safe home to excellence center, so that we don't stigmatize them.
Right.
So when they see a girl in there, they don't say, oh, she's here, she's been raped. So So we're making it look like it's an excellent center. We're going to have two surgical theaters. We'll have private rooms, and we'll have wards for severe cases, minor cases. Mm-hmm. We'll have places that they will stay until we're able to relocate them, if that is what is needed. And on the second floor will all be offices for agencies that are dealing with only rape cases. So everything will be under one roof.
And how will a woman or girl be referred to that centre? Could she turn up herself?
It will mean when that centre is ready, it's going to be open to the whole country.
Open to everyone?
Yes. We chose to do it at the military hospital because the new military scares a perpetrator.
Right, okay.
So we said, okay, because sometimes also you'll have a safe home and the perpetrator will want to find a way to get there to silence the child.
It's a very real challenge in the UK still as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that I know. Mm-hmm. So making sure that they don't have access to this child. We're using the fear factor of the environment where the safe home is. So if you pass through 34 and just see the kind of structures that are going on at the moment, every building there is at the moment done by this office.
When do you think it will open then?
We do.
That's always a big question. No,
we are working on it. We don't get money from anybody.
Mm-hmm.
So we fundraise in-house, we fundraise in Sierra Leone.
Mm-hmm.
And then lately we have Sierra Leoneans who did a fundraising in the state when we were for the UN General Assembly.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't much, but at least they did something. And we were able to raise about $100,000, yeah? Something like that. For international donors, we don't get money from anybody.
I imagine most people have their money tied up in major programs. I think the good thing is we're all at least focused on the same
indeed
thing.
I don't bother myself with international donors, because I keep saying, do you want results or you just want policies?
Mm.
Because if I want results, then you deal with the person that gives you the result. Well, I can't be bothered, I'm just a first leader. So I'm not able to put a time frame as to when. Our hope and pray is that this year the Excellence Center should be ready.
Mm-hmm.
If not, some of the challenges we had when we started the project, we had a whole lot of rocks. Because when they gave us the land, we didn't know the land is all full of rock.
Oh, so you had to clear it all.
We had to remove. So it took us almost 8 months to remove those rocks for us to be able to, because the design of the center really, basically, when you come in, the parking should be under the building. So when you come in, for you to go into any part of the building, you have to be bused in.
Right.
For safety reasons.
Yeah.
So that was our challenge, but we've gone past that now. We've done the retaining, and at the same time, because I'm not doing one building, we're doing 8 buildings.
Because you've got everything at a one-stop shop, effectively.
We have the one-stop center, which is the Excellence Center. We're doing an administrative building, because at the moment, with the military hospital, majority of the doctors are at the police headquarters here in Wilkinson Road.
Mm-hmm.
When they rush with somebody there, they had to call here before they start moving to go there. So we decided to build an administrative building, which is almost ready.
Right.
So that every doctor, every personnel that works at the hospital should have their own office on campus. So that is ready. We've done the 100-bed pediatric ward for children. That also is ready. We've done the nursing school, because we want to make 34 the biggest government hospital. So we've done the nursing school, because we want to be able to train nurses so that when the hospital is ready, they have staff ready to take over. So we've done the nursing school, which is at 90% completion now. So because we are not doing one one project, they gave us the land to do the excellence center. But then when I looked at the kind of thing we want to do with the excellence center and the buildings that are around it, I felt like no. So we started breaking the buildings one by one and building. So we've done 2, 3. We are now going to start the 100 bed for the female ward. We have a dedicated female ward, dedicated male ward. Then the excellence center will be in the middle of all of it.
Right.
So
it's going to be quite an enterprise, my goodness. Yes. So it's quite an undertaking.
We're looking at making 500 bed hospital.
500 bed hospital. Yes. And having the staff to support.
So that's the reason why we have the school.
Yeah.
And the school is almost ready. By April, the school should be able, the administrative building, the 100-bed pediatric ward, and the school will hand them over to the military by April, while we concentrate now on the female ward, male ward, and the excellence center.
And one of the things, given that you're so active in this field, that I wanted to ask your view on, one of the things I'm picking up on the Women and Girls Agenda is how disabled girls are even more disadvantaged and so vulnerable than perhaps in many, many other places, including things like night husbands visiting them at night, them being abused and goodness knows what. I wondered if that was something you picked up on your tour and how sort of like a tremendous facility like you were talking about might help.
It's a situation that is very peculiar and difficult for the agencies that are dealing with it. Us personally, we have not taken that because of all the other things that we're dealing with. But the Minister of Social Welfare, I know last year, this year, she said this, disabled and persons in trafficking persons are her agenda.
Okay.
And that is her biggest focus for this, especially this 2022. So she will be in a better, because
that's
her focus. She's totally focused on that, and that's what she's been doing since, because the Ministry of Gender and Social Welfare was together.
That's right, they're able to take and then,
them. Yeah, yes, they separated them. When they were together, we were working with the minister. When they were together, we started the Hands of Our Girls campaign together. So basically, we have the same focus. We wanted to do the same thing. Our agenda is the same. They've separated the ministries. Now, the new minister
agenda.
I don't know what her agenda is.
Right.
So I will not be able to say, well, this is what she's doing, or this is what she's focused on. I have not worked with her.
I think there's a big focus on the gender empowerment, or the gender equality and women's empowerment bill. I think there's a number of big things that are happening in the gender spaces in that.
So. Yes, well, with the gender bill that is there, this is something that when we came, we started everything. But of course, somebody has to continue. So I think that is our focus. It was the Minister of Social Welfare started putting it together.
Right.
And with consultation with UN Women and other agencies, that was when the rape issue became so prevalent to a point where His Excellency declared a state of emergency.
Yes.
So most of those things were basically things that she started working on. And when they separate the ministry, this one now is continuing on that. But when it comes to the advocacy and the implementation, I'm not sure if I know what, or maybe she's just focusing on the gender bill.
One other bit to get your perspective on, actually, Rex, is that given that you are travelling, you've got this bird's eye view, You touched on this earlier. I was intrigued to hear men coming in behind you after you're giving the difficult messages, you're out there, you're talking about this issue, and then that's making them feel empowered to say, well, actually, I don't like this either, and I want to see this change.
Yeah, what we did, what was the most fabulous thing we did with the Hands of Our Girls, we reached out to the custodians of our traditional homes. Those are the paramount chiefs.
Yes, of course.
So we worked with all 197 paramount chiefs around the country, every one of them.
And how were they? Were they receptive to this? What was your experience?
Absolutely. Even some, at least maybe 1%, just feel like women are trying to be too powerful. But every other person are on this, and even when we don't go, they implement. Because they see it now as their agenda. Even where, I mean, paramount chiefs started to launch the Hands of Our Girls in their own chiefdoms. They started, I mean, they will arrest and they will hand over to the police and they will call us.
Or if you can get the paramount chiefs engaged, given the political role that they're in, I think that's
every single paramount chief, every single paramount chief is part of this project. And we're able to get the religious leaders also. So we started preaching it in the mosques, they preach it in the church. Everyone was talking about it, everybody, and they still do. The churches, the big pastors in the churches will tell you that we definitely don't want this to continue. So we talk about it in our churches. They make it a sermon in churches and mosques. And we're able to work with the teachers again. Some of the teachers are the perpetrators.
Yes, I hear.
We call them out. We tell them we know what you're doing. And then we tell the girls that we know what you're doing too. And you should not be doing this because it's not going to help you tomorrow. And that also, we have the teachers working. But our biggest perpetrators were the Okada riders. The guys that ride the bikes, they are more close to our daughters than even us. In the morning, they go to the houses and pick the kids to take them to school. And gradually, they become close to that child.
So effectively, like grooming a child almost, or making them feel comfortable?
No. You pick a child, their job is to pick the child up, drop them to school. But they sit on the same on top of the bike, and this girl, there's nothing separating the girl from the person driving the bike.
Yeah.
And eventually, they started leaning on this man.
Right.
And they started getting too close, and most times they end up becoming pregnant.
It's very difficult, isn't it? Because it's we don't want to shame girls. It's inappropriate to shame girls for a crime. Any man that takes advantage of a woman, it's a crime, isn't it? But there's a whole education piece for absolutely everybody.
We reach out to them. We call them out over and over. Them and the police, we call them out. We call them out like crazy. And they even wrote us an official letter that I should leave them alone, that they're not going to do it anymore.
My goodness. Have you seen a change? Have you seen something change as a result?
When we go to campaign now, they join us and they are also talking about it in their circles.
Yes.
They're telling each other that we cannot do this, we need to stop, you know. And
but this is really positive. I think the one thing, and I hope I can be kind with you, is this is really inspiring to hear this type of change. And since I've come in, I've had lots of men actually in the Sierra Leone scene, even the most senior. So fortunately, His Excellency the President, lots of the ministers, the Vice President. I meet people all the time that tell me that they're gender champions and keep the sheep, way more than in the UK, if I can tell you that. So that bit's really good. That bit, I think, is really positive. But still, it still is challenging, isn't it?
It is.
The reality on the ground is it is still one of the worst places in the world to be a woman, for a number of different reasons. So there's a disconnect between the very strong intent at the most senior levels, which I'm delighted to see, and I don't think many countries can rival, and then the reality of being a woman, and not just a girl, but also actually in your position, public figures, political figures, it looks like a tough gig. Actually,
every district have their own story. Mm. Every district have their own to tell. That's all I can say. Most of those men that claim to be gender activists are actually perpetrators.
Mm.
So, we'll see. But my promise to every one of them mm-hmm. is simple. I don't care which position you hold in this country. If you rape a girl, I'll come after you like a rebel. That is my position.
That is a stern warning.
That is my position. So if they've now all become he or she, then it's a good thing.
But if you've got a country like Sierra Leone that's got over 51% women, mm-hmm. anyone that does things that hold women back, make them feel second place or not able to exercise their rights, is sort of holding the country back as well, as far as I'm concerned. So.
Indeed. Well, again, with education, that will change. The girls are changing,
mm-hmm.
even from our results and public exams.
Yes.
The girls are doing extremely well.
Yes.
And they're basically making us so proud, because every public exam in this country, the girls are leading by a far.
I saw this actually because I was delighted. I don't know whether you've come across it, Your Excellency, but our Lady Liang program mm-hmm. is in about 16 districts. Through that, there's 46% more girls in mm-hmm. school mm-hmm. under the policy that His Excellency has promoted, and also doubling the exam classes. There's no good just being in school. Mm-hmm. You need girls to get the results and go on to the jobs.
Mm-hmm.
So we've definitely got a shared agenda on that front, and it's fantastic to see. The next stage, of course, would be those girls having access, if they want to jobs and economic mm. participation.
You know, the thing is, even in England that I was, I have lived for 22 years, governments don't provide jobs for everybody. It's the private sector.
Mm.
The private sector is the one who provides jobs. Mm. I mean, for the 22 years I spent in England, I worked in a government institution once. Mm. Every other place I have worked is a private sector business.
Yeah.
So I think our private sector had to be revamped and given opportunity. So more entrepreneurship, we should have those opportunities. And I also think and believe that the young people today should also not just be preparing themselves to go and work in an office, but be their own boss.
Mm.
I think that's another thing that we've started working on. We're going to be going around the universities and start mm. talking to the university kids to prepare them mentally.
Mm.
Government can only provide certain number of jobs, and the number of students that come out of universities every year, that job is not available.
Mm.
So if you're going to university to come out and wait for government paid job, there's going to be a problem, because America, England, that everybody fancy to run to, they don't have it.
No, it does. You don't, and actually it's unhealthy to have complete dependency on the state, isn't it? So I think you're absolutely right. Jobs creation comes from
mm-hmm.
a really healthy private sector. And I think there's two parts to that. One is trying to make the investment and business climate here as attractive as possible. So a big part of that is why you sometimes see me on Twitter sending lots of photos back of Sierra Leone on everyone to know how fantastic my Barcelona is. But there's another point, and I have I am privileged enough to be able to have frank discussions with you, with His Excellency, with ministers. There's work to be done to make the business environment appealing to businesses here.
Mm-hmm.
Many international businesses have a challenging time getting work done here or investing here, and that stops job creation. But the other piece, I think it's absolutely right, if we can encourage people early on to think, what can they do themselves, that's great.
From the moment you go to college or university, you start to prepare yourself and say, you know, when I leave, this is what I want to go and do, you know, not to think that by the time I leave here, there's going to be a government job waiting for me.
Mm-hmm.
Government jobs are, how much do they pay when you're a private sector?
I think the other appealing bit of what you've set out there is the private sector is, I'll describe this as colorblind in the political context, mm-hmm. because the private sector, it's less of a factor. Mm-hmm. So it's, mm-hmm. I think, actually anything that can blur political boundaries.
A private sector, if you're a serious private sector, politics should not be in your agenda.
No, it should be jobs creation in a sustainable and green way, ideally. Well, this sounds exciting, things on your mind.
We're starting with, I mean, Salim was just briefing me. We've already started talking to the universities. Mifti Magai is one, and mm-hmm. Afobe College another.
Okay.
Excellent. We just need to start putting dates together and start going to them. Well, we've engaged Mifti Magai twice. So,
what do you think the youth need to alight that entrepreneurial spirit? What would make it practical for someone to come out of university and think, I'm going to do my own business?
Well, again, it's motivation, mm-hmm. and believing that you can. What we have in Sierra Leone is a gap in between. Now, majority of the youths that were here doing the work, they did not have the opportunity to be educated. Mm. Now, those young teenagers, those kids that went through the war, and now people like us in our own age group, so you have this 30, 40, 50, this age group in Sierra Leone who did not go through formal education. So then, it's a huge number. And that number are the ones you want to provide for, mm. as a government. But then, if they do not have the required education, how do you do that? So that is where the skill come in. Mm. Now, with the peace and the democracy and everything, and every young child in Sierra Leone today wants to go to school. They don't just want to go and finish GCSE. They want to go to university, mm. and they want to be a degree holders. So that's the difference.
Yes. Okay.
So these kids today, again, like what His Excellency said, so we let these kids value education. They're not going to be voting for His Excellency next election because they are not of a voting age. Mm. By the time they are going to be of a voting age, he's not going to be here.
No.
But he would have left them with the security that education is the only thing that can change their lives. So those kids, when they are educated and they are enlightened, they have a degree, when they come out, their own children are going to be educated. Mm. Because you're going to instill what you have in your own child. So that gap is the gap that at this moment, you know, we need to find something for what?
Yes, exactly. It's the gap to close. Mm-hmm. And it's the gap before the private sector is totally vibrant.
Yes.
Before the energy and access, the energy and water access is at a level where more businesses can invest. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's the transition.
So that the gap between the war and then after the war and then what happened to them to this day, mm-hmm. those people, it's a difficult terrain to find yourself. Mm. Now the world has gone digital. Everybody's talking about digitalization. Mm. If you can't even read and write.
No, then you're locked out from that, aren't you?
So, and it's not like 5 people, not 10. Mm. We're talking about hundreds of thousands.
And I think, and you paint it very eloquently, and I think the thing that's on my mind as well is, how do you close that gap in a sustainable way that preserves Sierra Leone's future? So when I was up going to Camaquae and I was on the ferry where the chain is pulled to get you across you saw so much logging, obviously, and I understand why there are things like illegal logging and other things that damage the environment happening, mm. because for many people who don't have that education, exactly as you say,
that's the only way of
the only way of finding a way to get food in their belly.
Yeah.
So that piece, if we are, and I like the idea of investing in entrepreneurship or thinking about jobs creation, mm-hmm. getting the private sector better, we also need to educate people to think, well, how can I, whatever I build as a business, whatever I invest in, how how can I make sure it's not going to trash the environment that is my children's future?
All that goes into enlightenment. When I know something that is right and wrong, now it's my choice.
Yes, particularly then if that choice, you can make that choice and still put food in the belly.
Indeed. So that's my British mentality to kick in.
Well, I'm delighted to hear it. You've got a lot on your plate. And what I'm particularly delighted, you know, as someone that is learning, and I will always be learning about this country for the time that I'm here, I'm delighted to have that privilege. Anything that can also help mix up and get us away from the political divides that exist across the piece is a positive. If people can be educated and enlightened about the potential for the country, that's got to be a good thing, I think, hasn't it, for everybody.
I am looking forward to, you know, when you crave, you crave in you so much for your people, you want, it's like, you wake up from this world that you know, and then you come to this other world, and you're wishing, like, everything, why is in England to come here, but how do you move it? And the only way you can is educate them, talk to them. I believe in 15 years from now, when all of these kids now, the teenagers, the kids, they've all transformed and they've actually got the right education, we are back to where we were as the Ottoman of Africa. I believe that Sierra Leone will not only be a great nation, but it will be an enviable place for everyone. And I'm very sure it will happen.
Well, anything that I can do to help that, because that's our shared interest. We've got a really strong history, as you know, on every single level. We've got a strong history, then we've got day-to-day links that bind our countries together every single day, from academia, family, theatre, culture, activism. I think we would share and want to support a vision for Sierra Leone.
And we will invite you. The next time we come into, when we're doing the distribution of sanitary, when we start, we'll start in the oven here, and then you will see. So you just see the difference, and you see the appreciation level, how different it is. You will see, you will look at a child, you yourself, you just want to cry, because
I can imagine
the appreciation and the love they will show you, the gratitude. And for what? How much do you pass on your pardon?
No, it's an eye opener. It's absolutely an eye opener, isn't it? I had it very briefly travelling in Vogue, Kenmore and Kane, and visiting some schools that we worked with. It's inspiring that girls and women succeed and that they dedicate themselves to their studies and do what they do. It's horrifying what they have to put up with. So I can imagine how that's a game changer, a life changing impact.
So we're looking forward, but this time we're trying to change the dynamics because the boys, they keep asking, are we not your children too?
Oh, I can imagine. We're double them. So like, what's in it for me?
Yes, exactly. We're brainstorming now to
That's
see,
interesting.
You know, this time when we're going out, we have to go out for both boys and girls because I cannot face them for the third year.
No, that's tricky. But they all face different challenges. I imagine it might be around access to materials.
And then you think, you start thinking, do you give them condoms? And I'm thinking, I'm against sex altogether.
I suppose, yes, exactly. You want to incentivize another behavior. This is a minefield, isn't it? It's an absolute minefield. But there will be something.
So, yeah, we're actually on that research as to what you give to teenage boys.
Yes, exactly. I mean, I think there's definitely an education piece there as well, isn't it? About what it is to interact with girls, what's okay, what's not.
Well, they've been very supportive.
Yes.
Even when we do the sanitary pad, when we're distributing, the boys come. The boys will be the champion for the day.
Yes.
They will sit and listen to the whole thing.
Yeah.
And it changes some of them. They become like really, you know. So we've been putting them through this.
Yeah.
A whole year, 2 years, and I'm saying to myself, no, this year, I have to look. Even if it's a chocolate, I will find it.
Well, I will watch and see what your
order is. I need to say thank you for coming.
Oh, you're very welcome. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Now we will find for them.
Just to say, gentlemen, thank you.
Just to say, yes, exactly. That's
honestly,
right.
For now, that's
listening as well. Yes, exactly,
you know, and they take it on board. And the boys, even the other day, was it on Friday? Mm-hmm. I was involved, and I had this session with about 2,000 school kids, and I was saying to the boys, have you taken your hands off my girls? They're all screaming, yes!
They know the slogan.
Yes,
exactly.
We don't touch them. I'll ask the girls, have they stopped? They said, no, they don't touch us. They don't touch them. And the boys will be saying, no, say the truth. We don't touch you.
Right, okay. You can see the fear in their eyes. So, yes, exactly.
We don't touch you. No. Like, even if they come near you, no, they don't even come. We don't touch them.
Right, okay, my goodness. So the transformation is complete. So
it's good. But I'm looking forward to when we will start. I will just invite you to one.
Lovely.
And
thank
if
you so
want
much.
To do more than one.
I will prepare my energy. I will rest beforehand.
Have a Lucozade ready?
Yes, Lucozade ready. Take supplies with me. No, well, thank you very much, Your Excellency. I think it's really good to hear. I'm always motivated and excited to have a conversation with strong female women that are focused on how we can make women and girls' lives better. So I very much appreciate the time.
Thank you so very much.
Thank you so much.
Have a very good afternoon.